Hi, consumers of the materialistic world. Welcome to the first episode of Minimalism 202. If you were to pick the most time-abiding individual in your life, who would you pick? Say your life depended on it. Think of someone disciplined and punctual to the core. That someone does not necessarily have to be an animate object. This broadens the horizon for animists, believers in the earliest releases from animism, the essence of which is that all objects, places, and creatures possess soul. Now think like an animist, which is the most time-abiding entity in our life. The timekeeper, isn't it? Timekeeper has a grave responsibility. Cesium clock is a near-perfect timekeeper. Say, cesium clock ceases to work. Say it fails. Say all of technology fails and we are back to square one. We are back to being a level zero civilization on a Kardashev scale. So back in time with regards to time, what do we have at our disposal? Ancient timekeepers, celestial bodies. And which is the most reliable celestial body? By reliable, what I mean is, if it ceases to exist, so do we. Not the other way around. The sun, or as the Aztecs called it, Huitzilopochtli. Aztecs were animists and they revered sun. They worshipped it. They found sun reliable, though subject to terms and conditions. What were these terms and conditions? Aztecs believed that the sun god Huitzilopochtli was in a constant war against the forces of darkness. By night, these forces grew stronger, trying to devour Huitzilopochtli with all their might. For Aztecs, it took sacrificial offerings to feed the sun, to grant Huitzilopochtli the strength to defeat the forces of darkness and continue to rise every single day. If you ever played Age of Empires Moctezuma Conqueror's campaign, you might remember this quote on Aztec priests by Cuauhtemoc, Eagle Warrior of Tenochtitlan, which goes like this. The gods want more sacrifice was their answer. That was always their answer. These offerings were gruesome. The closest you can relate to it is by watching the scene from The Last of the Mohicans, where Magua rips the heart out of gray hair. Animism is like a kid believing in Santa Claus. Once the kid matures, it realizes the truth. Human civilization has matured enough to realize the truth that sun does not need sacrifices to continue to rise, though it still has a lot of maturing to do. Sundial, the earliest timekeeping device, finds its origin some 5,000 years ago, though obsolete and not as reliable as the atomic clock. The point here is not the reliability of sundial, but the sun. No matter what, sun will continue to rise and set every single day. Whatever the weather conditions be, you'd not find the sun shirking, not whining, asking for a leave. You'd never hear sun telling that it would like to chill and take a day off. That would be ironical for someone as hot as 6,000 Kelvin at the surface to chill. Awe-inspired, you tell the sun that it is disciplined and punctual to the core. It will revert back. That I don't know of. But I certainly am hydrogen and helium to the core, and that's how I generate massive amount of heat and energy through the process of fusion, and this energy forms the basis of life on your planet. We know this energy as insulation, incoming solar radiation. Sun is not just a reliable timekeeper, but also a reservoir of energy. That's how cool it is. So cool that the folks out there practicing different religions designated a specific day in its name. There are solar calendars, sun salutations, and harvest festivals attributed to it. They all have a specific purpose. A Sunday, not necessarily a Sunday, for introspection, rest, and worship. Abrahamic religions each have their day of Sabbath tied to sun, not necessarily on the same day. Solar calendar is used for agricultural and religious purposes. Sun salutation is a great way to start the day. Harvest festival is a way of showing gratitude to the sun, to pay obeisance. These harvests are made possible only by the energy that sun radiates. Now, the important question is, how much of this insulation are we harnessing? As per Kardashev scale, we would be somewhere around 0.7 type 1 civilization. and it would take us another century to attain type 1 status. The bottom line is that as the civilization progressed, in totality our ability to harness insulation increased. But what about at an individual level? Leave aside the instruments and devices at our disposal. Fundamentally, how much of the solar energy are we harnessing at an individual level? Vitamin D deficiency, inability to handle stress, prevalent depression are some of the markers of low exposure to sunshine in modern day. There even is a sad term, literally. Seasonal affective disorder, also known as the winter blues. It is experienced in winters, especially in places farther from equator, where the days are shorter and sunlight is scant. That's how much of an impact sunshine has. Our exposure to blue light has increased instead of sunlight. It has been shown that significant exposure to sunlight can aid in better handling PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. Instead, we are relying on artificially induced bright light therapy to mimic the benefits of daylight in order to produce serotonin and other good hormones. Our first nature is to connect with nature. A lot of miseries that pile upon the modern world is a consequence of altering this nature and the nature itself. Homo sapiens considered themselves as the prime species with an utter disregard for fellow creatures. We tend to abuse natural resources. Nature naturally retaliates for course correction. COVID-19 possibly is one such instance. At least this is where animists got it right, where all entities, animate or inanimate, are considered equal. Our hunter-gatherer ancestors, sun-bathed and sun-kissed, took privilege in relishing the natural things in life. The warmth of the sun, magnificence of sunrise and sunset, the ebbing pristine water, rustling of leaves caressed by the winds, worshipped them, considered them as a vital life force, hence were judicious in consuming them. So how does animism fit in the scheme of things that is minimalism? When was the last time you witnessed sunrise or sunset, soaked in the magnanimity of sunset, witnessed it slowly submerging below the horizon and waved goodbye to this cool friend? Every sunset is an opportunity to reset. It is one of the finest moments to introspect, rewind, and then wind up the day. It is a promise that the subsequent sunrise will be brighter, that it will brim us with energy to take us throughout the day. When was the last time you watched a show on OTTs like Netflix, Hulu, or Amazon Prime Video? Very often our conversations revolve around that trending show. With so many forms of entertainment, do we really feel fulfilled? These are top-ups, over and above the finer things that bring intrinsic joy. That's what OTT means, isn't it? Over the top. Once you have aligned yourself with the forces of nature, once you have witnessed the magnanimity of Hidzilo Postli, everything fades in comparison, technically. So next time someone brings something like this in conversation, like, did you watch that latest trending show? You have a better answer, so better answer. Did you witness the sunset today? It was the most beautiful sunset I have ever seen. It was like a super sunset. This reminds me of the apple scene in the movie Into the Wild. When was the last time you did a sun salutation? When was the last time you did a workout on Cult Fit or home workout? Like I said, these are top-ups. Perhaps top apps on App Store. Sun salutation, say Surya Namaskar, is not a mindless exercise in exercise. It has been designed mindfully. Exposure to sunlight, full exposure of subtle body parts and chakras, mindful chants exhibiting gratitude. This is something to learn and incorporate in one's life and not depend on an app or cell phone. By the way, which app do you use for editing your photos, applying filters and adding that finishing touch? Do you know what is the best time to click photos? After sunrise and before sunset, it's called the golden hour. To soak in and preserve the colors in the sky, all you need is your eye. Not a camera, not an app, a wee bit of mindfulness. The bottom line is aligning yourself with Hidzilo Postli, the sun god. You won't need an alarm clock, one less thing. Witnessing sunrise and sunset brings the sheer joy unmatchable by any source of entertainment. One less thing. Practicing sun salutation, you don't need an app. One less thing. Sun. You need just one thing. Sun. No matter where you are, except poles during winters, It is at your service, and it's a cool friend to have. You don't have a cell phone, no internet, no electricity. Lights will guide you home, not just metaphorically, but literally as well. Combination of sun and north star can determine one's latitude and aid in celestial navigation. Now it's up to you to align your attitude, hoping an effective vaccine for COVID-19 is just around the corner, and it won't be monopolized like when Jonas Salk, the developer of polio vaccine, was asked why didn't he patent it. He replied, "Can you patent the sun?" A statutory warning. Accept sunrise and sunset, do not stare directly into the sun. In Darren Aronofsky's first feature film Pi, the protagonist says, "When I was a little kid, my mother told me not to stare into the sun. So once when I was 6, I did." Doesn't matter what your age is, do not stare directly into the sun, except sunrise and sunset. Or go ahead, do it, braveheart. Once the lockdown gets over, we get out of our burrow and soar high in the sky with this newfound freedom. Till then, signing off with this short poem. How many places have you been and how many sunsets have you seen? While you're young and good to go, it won't hurt to get out of your burrow. 'Cause when you're old and slightly frail, you'll still live to tell this tale. That how many places have you been and how many sunsets have you seen?